afternoon, and welcome to the Wednesday afternoon press conference here at the 233rd meeting of the American Astronomical Society in Seattle. The topic of today's briefing is black holes. We'll get that in just a minute. I first want to let you know that we're webcasting the session. I'll be assisted today by my AAS Media Fellow, Kerry Hensley, who will be monitoring the webcast and will be answering questions from the audience. If you have a cell phone on you or anything else that makes electronic beep, would you please silence it? I have at last gotten the first pre-day's press conferences archive videos up to the archive webcast page. So if you missed one of those briefings, you want to watch the webcast, those links are live. I still haven't gotten all the presentations, so I'll have to put them behind in a second. If this is your first AAS briefing, let me just review the ground rules real quickly. I'll introduce the topic and all the speakers. They'll then present one after the other, and we'll hold all the questions to the end. We'll start with questions here in the room, and then go to questions on the webcast. So, as I said, the topic this afternoon is black holes. This time it's black holes in galaxies near and far. We have four presentations. Two of them are linked to articles that are appearing in journals today. The first paper, Gravitationally Lensed Quasar at the Epoch of Reionization from Xiaohui at the University of Arizona, that's appearing in the Astrophysical Journal Letters today. And I appreciate that the editors of that journal, which is trying to get it up, pulled all of the stops to get that report online today. The second presentation, Constraining Black Hole Scenes Through Observations of Tidal Disruption Events, is by Dheeraj, Pasham, at the MIT Kavli Institute. He goes by DJ. And his presentation, or his paper, is appearing in Science today. And again, we worked hard with the editors of Science to make sure that this paper could get online this afternoon in time for the briefing, so that Dheeraj didn't have to type it. The third presentation is by Amalya Johnson from Columbia University. She's talking about an X-ray cavity around the hotspot in Cygnus, double shaded by the jet. And the fourth presentation will be by Erik, Rosolowsky at the University of Alberta, PHANGS-ALMA, Physics at High Angular Resolution in Nearby Galaxies, which is kind of comma, large millimeter signal.
So today I'm going to present to you the discovery of the brightest quasar in our universe, which is standing at a driven velocity of 600 billion solar velocities at a distance of
12.8 billion light years away.
This object is boosted by gravity lensing, in fact, from an intervening galaxy. So this also makes this object the highest representative object of the quasar that we have that we mentioned in the paper that published today. So quasars are active nuclei of distant galaxies with enormous power from accretion of gas and dust into the central black holes of this massive or millions of billion solar masses. And because of their tremendous luminosity, we can see them literally across the universe. Most distant objects, therefore, can allow us to study the distant past of the universe,
involved, from the dark ages to the cosmic dark,
to the mission of the first galaxy. In the last 20 years, there are about 200 quasars discovered within the first 1 billion years of cosmic
history,
with the most distant quasar known at about 13 billion light years away, or about 700 million years after Big Bang. And their luminosity ranges from a few to about 300 billion solar luminosities. This earlier this year, we discovered even more extreme objects. This object is called J0439 plus 1634 boring name, but it was measured at a redshift of 6.51, which translates to a distance of 12.8 billion light years away, well into the epoch of reionization when the universe is transforming. And what makes this object truly amazing is its extremely high luminosity. It's about 600 trillion times the sun, so it's about twice as bright as its close competitor was discovered 2 years ago. This picture shows the ground-based image in different wavelengths in spectrum of Quasar, which you can see in the spectrum, different emission lines coming from hydrogen gas, from ionized carbon, and medium gas, which allow us to measure its distance and to measure its luminosity. We said it's 6 trillion solar luminosity. Now, even if it's real, then this object would have been powered by a black hole of about 10 trillion solar masses, and the host galaxy of this object would have been forming stars at a rate of about 10,000 solar masses a year. And that compared to Milky Way, which has a 23 billion solar mass black hole and forming stars at a rate of about 1 sun per year. So that begs the question of how the universe so young, only a few percent of the current age, can form such a massive black hole with such an intense star-forming galaxy around it in such a short period of time. That would be a challenge of how black holes and galaxies form in the universe in our theory. Or maybe there's something else, namely, it could be affected by the gravitational lensing effect. So gravitational lensing is in fact that if you put a galaxy along the line of sight between the observer and the quasar, then the strong gravitational force of the galaxy is going to warp the space-time around it, and the galaxy's light, the quasar's background light will be bent and stretched, and the quasar will be boosted and split into multiple images. There are a few hundred, couple of hundred gravitational lens quasars already discovered today. But the highest resolution lens quasar known is resolution 4.8, essentially about 12.4 billion light years. In other words, among about 500 most distant quasars we know, within the first 1.5 billion years of the cosmic history, none of those planets. So we were wondering from the discovery whether this J0439 could be the very first lens quasar in the universe and the light was boosted by the lensing. In fact, when we look at the spectrum of the quasar earlier, there is some hint of the light, there's some contaminants of another object in the spectrum, and some ground-based image show that this image of the quasar is slightly extended, with another hint that there may be another object blended with it. But this ground-based image, of course, we can't really tell, so we have to resort to Hubble space telescope objects. So this April, finally, we are able to get a deep HFC image of this object, which, as you can see here, split off into a multiple component. In fact, the quasar's light is split into three components. There's three lens, three image lens. And next to it, about only half parsec away, there is a bluer object that we interpret as the lensing galaxy, the galaxy causing the lens. So our interpretation is this. Basically, there is a quasar 13 billion light years away. And then there's the foreground galaxy about halfway. This galaxy is bending the light and split the quasar light in three images and actually So the light from the quasar is. Thank you.
are dictated by three parameters. November of 2014. Up and down, brightening and getting dimmer on a time scale of 130 seconds. And this is what is shown here. It's just a folded light curve where the X-ray flux, as you can see, is getting brighter at times and then just getting dimmer at times. And it was doing this brightening and dimming thing for at least 1.5 hours. So as I described, by equating this periodicity to various ways in which clumps of material can move black hole, we were able to estimate or constrain that the spin of the black hole has to be at least 50% of the speed of light. The mass that we used for this estimate was derived from the properties of the host galaxy. And we assumed that this clump is closest possible to the black hole allowed by GR, general relativity. If you assume that the distance is further out, you would only be pushing this spin constraint to higher value. So if you put this clump further out, you'd only require
also in a cluster of galaxies.
Says, and you said early is the challenge for theory. Given the expected masses of population 3 stars, given nonlinear structure formation, and given the physics of violent relaxation where large masses sink together to something, and a universe that's already a billion years old by the time you see this, forming extremely massive black holes early seems to be unavoidable. Why do we continue to say this? Why do we continue to say finding a black hole this big this early is such a challenge for theory?
Again, from Scientific American. A question for Dheeraj, Pasham. the spin rate of 50% the speed of light sounds crazy fast to me. Is it really fast? Is it surprising, or is it kind of what you expected? And how does knowing the spin rate tell you about how the black hole formed?
Christine Pulliam from the Space Telescope Science Institute. My question is for Amalya. I was wondering if we used Chandra to take extra long observations of other radio galaxies with radio lobes, might we find a similar cavity? Or do you think that the combination of having this galaxy particularly close plus the angle of the jet means that this is probably the only one we'll see?
Jim Annie consultant for Dr. Rosolowsky. Does your team have any thoughts about why high mass galaxies would be less efficient at producing stars than low mass?
Okay, we have a question for Dr. Fan from Monica Young at Sky and Telescope. She asks, Is it possible, and are there plans, to use this very high redshift quasar to investigate cosmology, such as estimating the Hubble constant?
Hi, I'm Regina Jorgensen from the Mariah Mitchell Observatory. I have a question for Dr. Pham as well about the intervening galaxy, the Lenser. What redshift is it at? Can you talk a little bit about it?